Is it possible to be too sensitive? Someone wrote to The Cut asking for advice on how to manage their crybaby tendencies. They called it that, not me. They say they burst into tears at anything from social injustice to how much their cats have grown. Is anyone here an easy crier? Jeremy, are you?
Oh, I'm not actually, no. I wish, a big part of me wishes I was, and I'm really trying to work on it. And I should say that lately, just given like with what's going on with what happened out West and like the revelations that are coming forward, you know, I've been like every time I see a Native kid right now, I'm like losing my mind. Mm. Just like trying to process that grief. But historically I had not been a crier, but I had been told I was too sensitive. So I think maybe my sensitivity might come through what I say rather than like how I let it out. But I want to start to let it out because I feel like grief doesn't go anywhere. It just sits in the body unless you process it, unless you like work through it. So we got to like let it flow. So too sensitive, I don't buy that. I think it's like it's a hard world and we need our crybabies to process and like feel for the world because there's so many people in this world that aren't tapped into that, you know.
Vivek, what about you?
I mean, before the pandemic, I would say that I was an out and proud crybaby, the C in 2S LGBTQC, if you will. you know, it's something that I felt really ashamed about because I would hear it a lot as a teenager, you're too sensitive. But now as an adult, like actually, I really feel like it's my job as a human and as an artist to feel deeply and passionately, and not just because it inspires me to make art, but also feeling passionately and deeply makes me want to try to make the world a better place. And, you know, I do think that there's maybe even some misogyny in this statement of too sensitive. Post-pandemic, or I mean, we're still here in the pandemic, I have to say I've been very numb, so it's actually been hard to get a good cry. And so the other day I was so desperate that I put on, bear with me, U2's Greatest Hits. And it actually worked. It actually worked. The tears just like came falling. I feel so much better now.
I cannot believe it. You heard it here first. Like, Vivek is a U2 stan. Whoa. I had no idea.
No shame. No shame.
Not at
no
all.
Shame needed.
Wow. Just surprised.
Joan wrote to us on Facebook and said, when I was younger, I guess I was sensitive and I cried a lot to the point where I still get made fun of as a crybaby by my family to this day, 39 years later, and a load of therapy to realize that it's just a form of coping and it's actually a normal response to stress and trauma, breaking the cycle with my kids who cry and learning that big feelings are okay. Joan, thank you for sharing that. I feel like you're in my head and I think a lot of people can resonate with that. Like like you both were explaining, like I was a bit of a crybaby when I was younger. I was Wednesday's child who's full of woe. Like I was born on a Wednesday. I'm attributing it to that. But I got known as this sensitive kid who used to cry. And then there was this one experience in school when I was around my son's age, actually around 8. And my teacher, who I liked so much, she saw me cry. I was crying about some kind of art project. I didn't get the right colors of construction paper. And I was devastated, of course, as an artiste. And afterwards, she held back one of my friends and told her my friend not to come to me when I cried. And I got this information to my friend, and I was devastated. And I remember distinctly kind of hardening my heart at that point.
No.
And it's funny
no.
because when I met my partner many years later, Jason, he said to me, "You're kind of an ice queen. Like, you don't cry about anything." He would cry at like a commercial that was sad. He would cry all the time. And I didn't. And it wasn't until I gave birth that I sort of cracked myself open again. I felt like I cried throughout most of season one. I was breastfeeding. I was just like leaky with emotion. But it's interesting raising a son, because my son, I really try to talk to him about, like, when he's crying, like, I comfort him. I let him know that tears are okay, and it's a great way to express that. But there's an interesting tipping point, because I also know that I have to prepare him for the world out there and how people judge, in particular boys. And that's that piece of misogyny that I feel like, Vivek, you were talking about. That
totally.
I don't know how we balance that out. Like, you do have to go into a world where everyone accepts anger as a better emotion than tears.
Right. And I think if we can also like start to reclaim that conversation of misogyny and as like, I can speak as like somebody who's, you know, at times male identified, but certainly was like raised as a boy I think we need to just demystify that, like, this is, it has to be okay for everyone to express in that way, because there's no, those kind of emotions need to move through our body, you know?
Yeah, I hear what you're saying, Cynthia, about, you know, a culture that generally isn't very kind, especially to boys who show emotion in the form of tears. But I also think it depends where you are in the world. There are many cultures around the world that don't get the spotlight here in the West, where, you know, men crying is generally accepted and seen as a wonderful thing. I think about, you know, right now at the top of the music charts, BTS, one of the great things that they've done is model a softer version of masculinity. I'm a big BTS fan, and every time I watch one of their, like, performance videos or concerts or reality shows, they're always crying. And it's not just one of them. It's all seven of them. If one's not crying, the other's comforting. If one's comforting, the other's crying. And generally in East Asian culture, I'm Chinese. I watch a lot of Chinese dramas. I also watch a lot of Korean dramas. In a movie or a drama, there is, like, the audience knows to wait for the key scene where the lead actor cries. It's now known as a thing that is a part of all of these dramas, like a highlight. And their tears are also beautiful. They're thick and bubbly, and the way that they roll down their faces is artistic. And so in other cultures, they've made this beautiful male crying as an art form. And I think that's really important for, you know, all of us to share. Not that these cultures are perfect and not misogynistic, because certainly they are quite patriarchal, but there is a softening that's happening in their cultural performances among their artists.
Okay, I'm really glad that...
artists, I want to just...
Sorry, go ahead, Jerry.
I just wanted to say that, like, misogyny affects men, you know, really heavily. And I think that's, as much as we can continue to acknowledge that misogyny is not just, like, a feminist problem that, like, women need to, like, call out. Like, it's in all of us, and we need to, like, look within and really challenge all of those assumptions that we make.
Indeed. Okay.